Okay, is my screen visible? Hello.
Yes, it's visible. Yes.
Okay. So this presentation, I'm going to discuss about the 3 points or the 3 topics during the today as well as the tomorrow session. One is of introduction of R language, and then we talk about the some basics of statistics, about the nature of data, measurement of scales, and the specific technique which is useful for analyzing the data. And later on, we will discuss about the testing of hypothesis, which include the parametric test as well as the non-parametric test. See, my session is usually, I have the habit of giving the session that we will do the practice together. So in between, anyone has any query, you please don't raise the hand, because I could not able to see your hands as well as the comments. So immediately you can unmute your mic and ask the questions, so that we can discuss at the again at appropriate way. So this particular presentation is prepared for the 7-day national workshop on use of statistical softwares R in research and development, organized by AK Das Gupta Center for Planning and Development, a center sponsored by Niti Aayog, Government of India, Vishwa Bharati, Shanti Niketan, West Bengal. I once again, the thanks to the organizer for having me and giving me the opportunity to share the knowledge with you. Well, you have heard many statistical softwares like SPSS. Even you can have analyzed the data using the Excel. You can have the analyze the data using the Minitab, MATLAB. So there are so many statistical softwares are available. SAS, SAS. These all softwares are commercial softwares. So R is a language, is a kind of a software which is a freely available. So when I'm saying that it is a language, don't worry, because I got the information from the organizer that many of are not aware about the R language. So don't worry about it. If you don't know the computers, then we still, you can learn the R language. It's a very simple language. Just you have to maintain the certain the hierarchy and certain rules. Keep in mind, you will easily able to analyze your data, which you are usually collecting during your research. So R is a language and environment for statistical computing and graphics. Basically, the main aim of the R language is that it is highly graphic oriented, and whenever you wish to do the any statistical analysis, you can easily perform using the R language. Earlier, there was a language called the S language, and which was developed by the Bell Laboratory, but it is a commercial language. And that is how the research community had joined together and developed the R language on the line of a S language. R provides a variety of statistical, especially linear and nonlinear modeling, classical statistical tests, time series analysis, clustering, and many graphical techniques. So you can do almost all possible analysis in the R language. One of the advantage of R is that, because most of the time that discussion always there, why R? R is open source. Okay, so you do not require to pay a single rupees for the R. It is available under the cloud. It is a freely available. You can use, you can install, and you can use as per your requirement. The advantage of R is that it can be compatible with the other platforms like Unix, FreeBSD, Linux, Windows, and macOS. So today, whatever we will discuss, or I am going to explain, because I am using the Windows at my university, and I am quite comfortable with the R language in the window version. So we will discuss on the R language for the Windows, but it can work in a various platforms. Command remain the same, little bit only the change of the command of a specific platform. That's all. The environment of R. R is an integrated suite of software facilities for data manipulation. Now, here I would like to have a question, because what do you mean by the data manipulation? Anyone from you? Data manipulation.
So does it involve data cleaning?
Pardon?
Does it involve data cleaning? Cleaning of data for analysis?
Data cleaning, somewhere you can say, but can you add something more?
Is it adding, inserting, deleting, and modifying that updating data?
In that way, it is correct. For example, most of the time, the people have the impression of data manipulation means, we do not have some observation. Let me manipulate. Let me add my own way. So this is not the data manipulation in the computer language. Data manipulation, as you rightly say, that if you wish to update your data, for example, my basic idea is that I am wish to study about the obesity. But how to measure the obesity? To measure the obesity, I require the some criteria which is given by the WHO, and WHO has given that criteria. It is based on the body mass index, BMI. So can you measure the BMI of individual directly? If I wish to measure the BMI of a participant of this national workshop, can we measure?
Yes, if we can height and if we have height and weight, I think that can
height
be
and weight.
Yes, so we cannot
could
directly
be measurable.
Measure.
Not directly, indirectly, we have to compute.
Directly measure. So that is how we have the data of a height and weight, and based on the relation between the height and weight, we can calculate the BMI. So data manipulation is that key. You have a specific objective, but directly the data is not available to you. Can we have the some sort of a functional relationship among the data, and then we can create the variable as per our requirement or as per the our study, and then we can use that data for further research. So data manipulation is nothing but the creation of a new variable based on the available information, or you can also say that the updating of the data. So you can also make various calculations and a graphical analysis using the R language. So it is not pure, only for the statistical analysis. You can do all addition, deletion, selection, everything can be possible in the R language. As per your requirement, you can fetch the data frame. As per the requirement, you can split the file. Many things are there. We will see the few commands during the discussion. As R is considered to be, as per me, it is a C. And I know the few drops of the C, and that I am trying to impart you. Once, the important thing is that the people have said that the good beginning is the half work done. Okay, so that means if you have the little bit idea how to swim with the R, then you can of course make yourself more and more good into the working with the R language. So my basic idea is that I wish to keep you that how to use the R language for the specific analysis. So R has an effective data handling and storage facility. You can handle the large database, and that is how in the data science now people are using mainly R and Python. Okay, because it has also the good storage facility, and it can handle the big data or the large data. A suite of operators for the calculations on array, in particular matrices. For example, if you have used the MATLAB, so MATLAB is nothing but it is a mathematical matrix laboratory. So that means whenever you wish to do the all kind of a matrix operations, then it can be also easily performed using the R language. Large and coherent integrated collection of intermediate tools for the data analysis. There are so many ready-made commands are available. For example, if I wish to evaluate the mean, perhaps in the basic Fortran and the other language, I have to write a command, or that I have to write a code to evaluate the mean. But in the R language, there is a command mean. Mean itself is giving the answer once you supply the data. So there are so many ready-made tools are available which can help you to analyze. Graphical facilities for the data analysis and display either on screen or hard copy. So of course, there are various graphical facilities are there. You can just take a printout or you can just copy and paste into the your documents. A well-developed, simple and effective programming language which includes conditionals, loops, user-defined recursive functions, inputs and output facilities. So it has the advantage that if you wish to use the, because it is a programming language. So if you wish to use the conditional statement like if else statements and other statement you can use. If you wish to use the for loop, while loop, like the other programming language like Java, C++, so you can also do that. Even it has the advantage that you can create your own function. Suppose the some codes or the some commands are not available in the R language. So you can also write your code as per your requirement and then you can use it. And sometimes you can also publish at your name. So for computationally intensive tasks, C, C++ and Fortran code can be linked and called at the runtime. So many of the codes in the R language are not developed. It is just taken from the C++, C and the Fortran via some connector. R can be extended easily via packages. Suppose the some of the codes are or the commands are not available. For example, if you are talking about the multivariate technique, okay. So if you are talking about the multivariate technique, like let us say factor analysis, so direct factor analysis codes are not available. So of course you have to load the certain library, and for the certain library you have to load the packages. So once you load that packages, you can use the commands of that particular packages. And then you can perform the factor analysis and other multivariate technique. So R can be extended via packages. By default, when you install the R and RStudio, it will load the base package. But whenever you require, you can download the package and you can run at a time of your requirement. Okay. There are about the 8 packages supplied with the R distribution and many more are available through the Crane website. Actually, Crane family, which is the taking care of the R. So R projects is taken by the Crane family. When you go to the Google and give the R, so R project has this main window. You can make this. These are the few screenshots I have taken that what kind of the analysis and the graphical techniques are facilities are available. So you can make the prospective plot, contour plot, box plot, scatter plot, okay, so many plot, pie charts, density curve. So many plots you can easily make. So these handouts I have given to all of you. So I will not go to the one by one line and read and this lot. What we do, we directly go to the R language. So I hope everyone has installed the R and R Studio.
Yes, sir.
I will show you the R environment and then directly switch over to the R Studio. The reason is the whatever we are doing in the R language that can be also done in the R Studio. But R Studio has some better facility than the R. So it has the kind of a window. The layout is like a MATLAB, which has the four windows. So similarly, R Studio has also the four windows. I will just show you whenever you install the R and R Studio. So basically you have to install first R, then R Studio. Okay. So you just click on the icon of a R, double click on that. It will open this kind of a window. So this is said to be R console. Is the screen visible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So this is called the R console, and you can say that this is angular, right angular bracket is nothing but command prompt. So you have to write your whole command over here and then just you can run it. For example, if I'm writing x equal to 2. Okay. And y equal to 3. Red is equal to x plus y. What is the answer? Red equal to 5. Okay. So it can works directly you have to write the command over here and you can get the output over here. Okay, but it is always advisable to write a code into the script window. So when you go to the file menu, there is option new script. Okay, so I will write here x equal to 2, y equal to 3, and z is equal to x plus y. Okay, this is the way. I will just, because I wish to see both window together, I can use the window tile vertically. Go to the window. There is option tile vertically. That means one side you can see the script and other side you can see the R console. How to open a script? Go to the file menu. There is option new script. It is window based version. File new. If you open the Word file, then if you wish to open a new Word, then of course file and then new. So here it is a new script or controller. And then just select all, Control R, it will execute in a right hand side. That, Control Z, it is giving the file. And if I wish to remove this particular output written on R console, then I have to use the command Control L. Which command? Control plus L key. You can see that you can write Control plus L. What happened? It will clear the screen. And to run the command, we have to use the Control plus R. Not necessary that you can go for the capital R. You can just give the Control R. Okay, to run the command. So whatever we are doing here in the R, same thing we will perform into the R studio. So now I will just take you to the R, because all the commands which we are writing in the R, the same command we have to write into the R studio. So that is how it is saying that before installing the R studio, you have to install R. Then you have to install R studio. Okay. So I will switch over and I'm just going back to the R studio. Fine.
Yes.
Not to worry if you don't understand what I have written. I will again explain everything in R studio. So just I would like to, because your workshop is a national workshop on R language. If somebody is later on coming and open the R, then you should not unaware that I have not seen this window. That is how I have shown you. Okay. Otherwise, the best way is to work with the R studio. Why? Because whenever you wish to extend your packages in R studio, it is better to download and extend the packages. I'll just close this. So to open a R studio, there is a icon. Or if it is not, then you can just type the R studio. Okay. And just double click on that. It will open the R studio. Everyone has opened the R studio window.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So when you open the R studio, it opens something like that. Just double click on the shortcut R studio, you will have this. Okay, so if you can see this window, it has the main window is divided into the four window, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Window one is nothing but it is associated where we have to write the R code. Okay, whatever the codes we wish to write, that you have to write here. Whatever the output you can see, that observe into the R console. So output can be displayed over here. You have to write your whole command over here. There is a button you can use one by one run, or you can see that there is a shortcut key, control plus enter. So control plus enter is useful to run the file. This is said to be a global environment which has the connected with your history, whatever the codes you have written, program, etc. And in this window, you can have several. If you click on the file, so there are files are available, and if you load the specific work directory, then you can access from here. Plot means whenever you can draw the plot, that your plot is executed over here, it will display over here. If you wish to load the packages, there is option packages. If there are some packages are available, you can select, it is automatically load over here, and then you can use the command. And if you wish to install the packages, then there is a command install. I will show you that there are a few packages we are going to install. Okay, then how these packages are useful to install and how to install. And one of the advantage of the RStudio is that if you are looking for a specific package, so of course in R and RStudio, the packages are dependent on the several other packages. In R, you have to see that which packages are dependent, you have to download everything, and then you have to run at your environment. But in RStudio, it has the advantage that it is by default, if you give the package's name, it will by default take the all the dependents package simultaneously. Okay. If you wish to see the help file, so there is an option help. Okay. So I will just show you how to go with that. Whenever you are talking about writing any program in a programming language, again, I'm telling you that don't focus more on the programming language. That I don't know any language and the sir has started about the language. Don't worry about it. Just if you remember the few names. So whenever you write any variable name in any programming language, the variable name always start with the alphabets. So you have to remember that. Variables start with alphabets. So we know that there are A to Z 26 capital letters. There are small A to Z small letters. Okay. So you can start variable name either capital A or small A. R is a case sensitive. If you write the capital and then you call the small x, then R doesn't understand because you have stored your output in a capital X. So you have to call capital X. So R is a case sensitive. Most of the command names are in lowercase. That means they are in a small letters. So first you have to that variable names should begin with the alphabets. Then it can be followed by numerals. Numerals means number. It is from 0 to 9. And special character. So special character, we usually use the underscore. Sometimes we can use the dot. So suppose you can write x underscore 1. This variable is valid. X1 is also valid. X dot 1 is also valid. But 1x is not valid. Okay. 1 underscore x is not valid. Similarly, you can write underscore x1. It is not valid because it is begin with the special characters. It begin with the numbers. Variable name should always begin with the alphabet. Just you have to remember. That's all. Okay. So can we write a few codes? I hope everyone has opened this window and everyone has this kind of window at your desktop. or a computer screen. I'll just increase the font size. If you wish to increase the font size, just go to the tools. There is a global environments. And if you wish to increase the font size, click on appearance. It is a 12. Let me make 13. Okay. And then press OK. I do not require this, so I can just click and drop. Here, if I will just press Ctrl L on a R console, Ctrl L stands for clear screen. So everyone try with me, Ctrl L in R console. So that your whatever the earlier you written in the screen, it is erased. Okay. Now I'm writing R can work as a calculator. X equal to, write the small letters, X equal to 2. Is it visible? X equal to 2, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I have written the one line. Equal to is for the assignment. That means I am assigning the 2 to the variable x. Mathematics, in mathematics, we write x equal to 2. That means x takes value 2. But when you write in a mathematics and when you write in a computer, there is a difference. In mathematics, equal to is the equation maker. But in a computer, it is an assignment operator. Whatever you have written on the right-hand side, it will assign to the left-hand side of a variable. In computer, if you wish to go for equation makers, then you have to use the double equal to signs. So if we require, we will see that. Okay, so here what happened? The value 2 is assigned to the variable x. Now, in this window, I am writing my all commands. Okay, single command should be write on a single line. And if you wish to write the more commands, then you have to use the semicolon. But keep habit of writing the single statement in a single line. So here x equal to 2, then I have to just enter. Then y equal to 3. And then I wish to make the addition of a two numbers, and that I wish to store into the variable z, x plus y. Everyone has to type with me. Type x equal to 2, y equal to 3, z is equal to x plus y. Okay. Now I wish to run this particular command. So whatever the line which you wish to run, you have to keep your cursor on that line. For example, if I wish to run the first line, I will keep my cursor here. It is not mandatory that cursor should be at the last position. It may be in between, it may be at the home, wherever. So if I wish to run this line, I can keep cursor anywhere in this line. And to run this, there is a button over here. You can just click. So when you click on that, just put your cursor over here. It is showing that to run this selection, the shortcut key is a Control Enter. So I always like to use the keyboard. So the key is a Control Enter. So as soon as I will do the Control Enter, the first line is executed. And you can see that in our console, it is showing that x equal to 2. And automatically your control will transfer into the second line. Whatever the control, this is called control, which is blinking. So your control is transferred on a second line. Then again, I will give the control enter. It will come to the next line because second line is run. And that is given in the R console. Then again, control enter. You can have a Z. But it has not shown what is the value of Z. Then what should I do?
Z is equal to.
Either I have a two option. I can use the print command. Print Z. So you can see that the command print, P-R-I-N-T, which I have written in a lower cases. And the advantage of the RStudio is, if I will write the print, immediately it is asking what you are looking for. So there are so many things. I would like to just print, just give the enter. It is by default giving the brackets. So in R language, there are three types of the brackets we are using. One is parenthesis. Second is square bracket. And third one is curly brackets. Parenthesis is mainly associated with the command. And you have to supply the arguments in the parenthesis. So whatever the arguments you have, that you have to supply into that. This square bracket is mainly used when you go for the matrix operations. And this bracket are mainly used when you go for the conditional statement or control statement. So conditional statement or control statement means you, if you are interested, use if, else statements. If you wish to go for the for loop, while loop. Okay. So right now we are not going to there. We will go with first this and then this, and I will take one example on this so that you can have the idea of use of all the brackets. Okay. So here I have to, which output I would like to show? See Z. I'll just give the print Z and then control enter. So now it has shown that Z has the output 5. But if I don't want to use the print command, I can just write the same variable name where the output is stored. So where output of X plus Y is stored, it is stored into the variable Z. I have to just write the Z and give the control enter. It is giving the same output. So no need to use the print command. Whatever the outputs you wish to observe, you have to see that where it is stored, just write that variable name and give the control enter or run the line. It will execute the output that Z has the sum of two numbers. The numbers are 2 and 3 and the total is 5. Suppose I wish to see the value of X and Y. So just type X and Y. Is that okay? So it is a simple use of assignment operators, simple use of arithmetic operator. We have used the plus. Plus means it is for one of the arithmetic operators. Suppose if I am giving Z1 is equal to X into Y. So X into Y means, what is the answer? X is 2, Y is 3. What is the product of 2, 3 are?
6.
So let me verify whether computer is giving the 6 or not. Yes, it is giving. So it is a multiplication of a 2 variables, 2 scalars. Suppose I am saying that X by Y. What is the answer of X by Y? X is 2, Y is 3. What is the answer?
0.66.
So let us verify. Yes. So it is giving by default how many decimal place? 7 decimal or 6? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So by default it is giving the 7 decimal precision. Okay. Suppose if you wish to find out the modulo. Remainder division, do you know that how to find out the remainders? Suppose if you divide 3 by 2, what is the remainder?
1.
So let me see that whether I will get the remainders is 2 or not. Okay. So if I wish to go for the remainder, so I have to use which operator? Percentage, percentage sign. So here I can make the comment. Anything is written after the hash, it becomes the comment. So here is that percentage, percentage operator is used as modulo operator, which will give the, again, I wish to give the another, which will give remainder of integer division. So comment is for you. because you are writing a code for your purpose. So sometimes if we forget why we have used this, so it is better way that keep a habit of writing the comments. Okay. If I'll just remove this, what happen? It will give the errors because it is saying that these are the some illegal words. But if I am giving the comment and then I will run, it is no problem. Okay, because compiler will understand that after hash, whatever written, it is a comment. Okay, so hash is mainly useful to write a comment. So there are a few commands. Hash is for the writing a comment. Control L for the clear screen. Control Enter for the run the commands. How to assign the variables. So single equal to sign is useful for the assignment. Sometimes people can assign in this way. X minus Y. So less than hyphen, it is also used as an assignment. X is 2, Y is a 3. So 2 minus 3 is? 2 minus 3 is?
Minus 1.
Minus 1. So let me see that answer is minus 1. Yes, it is minus 1. So that means this way also assignment can be possible. What I have done, I have just calculated difference of X and Y, and then I have assigned to the variable Z5. Okay. So whatever the letters in the assignment operator you are comfortable, you can use. If you are comfortable in equal to sign, so you can use this. If you are not comfortable with this, don't go for that. Otherwise, there is a chance of errors. Okay. So we have in a language, the thing is that first is declaration of variable. Okay. So we did not declare any variable, whether it is integer, float, character, nothing. So that is the beauty of R. You do not require to declare the variables. It is automatically understand that the variable is of a floating point integer or the integer or the character. Second one is that here we have seen that assignment operators. What is the assignment operator? Single equal to sign is useful for the assigning the value of right hand side variable to the left hand side, that we have seen. We have seen the arithmetic operators. What are that? We have seen addition. We have seen the subtraction. We have seen the division. We have seen the multiplication. We have seen the modulo operators. So if somebody say that, sir, we don't know the language, so I must tell you that when I am teaching C++, I will take 4 hours to reach up to the arithmetic operators. And you have studied in a 40 minutes. Okay, so that is the beauty of the R language. You do not require to declare. It will automatically understand. Okay, so you have us understand the concept of declaration of variable, assignment operators, and arithmetic operators. Is that clear? Any questions up to here? Yes, any question? You have to respond because in online mode, I am not in front of you.
So, no, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So now suppose if I wish to write a numbers which can start with 1 and end with the 10, then 1 colon 10, if I am writing X. Now what happened? Earlier X was a 2. Now it is not a 2. Why? Because I have reassigned the some new value. So make sure whenever you are using the variables, you should not go for the reassignment. Here now I have assigned the value 1 to 10. That means X start takes value 1, 2, 3 up to 10. So let us see what is the output. I'm writing Y equal to 10 to 1. That means it is a sequence which can decrease from 10 to 1 and the spacing between the two numbers is 1. 10, 9, 8, 7. Okay, so 1:10 means it is a purely a sequence between 1 to 10, and spacing between two numbers is 1. But suppose somebody said, no, I wish to write a sequence of 1 to 10, and the difference is 0.5. So command name is ACQ. You can see that it is in the lower letter. It is associated with the parenthesis where we have to supply the argument. The sequence starts from 1, end at 10, and the difference is 0.5. So you can see that 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, likewise. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Suppose you wish to write a, instead of the scalar, if you wish to write a column, like let us say 1, 2, 3. Let me come to this part. Suppose we have given the data in this way. X is 1, 2, 3. Sorry, A. So what is the transpose of A? A transpose, this is the column vector. So A transpose is 1, 2, 3. See, it is a row vector. So by default, when you write, it is in the R, it is a column vector. So I'm writing here, A equal to 1, 2, 3. 1, C. C stands for combining the data 1, 2, 3. And I am writing here A. So what is the A? Is a variable having a 3 elements. Which values are there? 1, 2, and 3. So whenever you collect the data of 100 respondents, suppose the data of age of 100 respondents, then you have 100 age are there. Suppose there are 23 participants in your class. Then of course, 23 informations regarding the age is available. Somebody has the 50, somebody has 20, somebody has 25, 38, something. So where you wish to store, so you will store this variable in the age, because your aim is to find out the average age of the respondents. You wish to find out what is the variation in the age. Okay, likewise. So you can declare them as a column and you can easily do. There are also other alternatives. Okay, suppose if I have data is available in the Excel format, then how to take this data? Suppose I have a data is available in the Notepad or the text format, then how to import the data into our language? So that I will discuss with you. Don't worry. So if I wish to find out the transpose of A, the command name is T. You can see that square bracket. I told you that whenever you come to the matrix notation, then you can use the square bracket. So anything written before the comma, it is talking about the row. Anything written after the comma in the square bracket, it is talking about the column. So here the comma 2, it means it is talking about the second column. Comma, square bracket, comma 3, that means it is talking about the third column. And here it is written that square bracket 1, it means it is talking about the first row. Is that clear? Because matrix usually we write in this way. Okay. And then if somebody say that obtain the first column. So this is the first column. C1, C2, C3. This is the first row, R1, R2, R3. So somebody said extract the first column, then you require this data. Somebody said no, extract the second row, then you require this data. Okay, so how will you extract this? So to extraction is that if somebody said that extract the second first column, that means C1 equal to A, comma 1. So that means I am talking about the first column. Somebody said no, I am interested to extract the second column. Then what should be the code? A because row, so that means second row and then comma. So this is the basically, because whenever you have a data is available, data usually come in a row column structure. Data frame structure is always a rows are the cases and columns are considered to be variables. For example, if you are saying that you have a, let us say, 22 participant, so your roll number, maybe sir has assigned some numbers to you for your attendance, so roll numbers, let us say 1, 2, 3, 22 or 23. Okay, and then I have asked your demographic information. What is your name? What is your age? What is your education qualification, etc. Okay, make sure that while in R language, whatever you write in Excel, there is no issue. In Excel, space is allowed. But when you write into the R language, the space between the variable is not allowed. You cannot write the education, then space, and qualification. We cannot write that. If we wish to write, we can write education under qualification. So make sure that you have. So here, this is said to be your variables of interest. These are the variables which you have collected. So these are columns are considered to be a variables. And these are the rows is nothing but your cases or your subjects, subjects, cases, whatever you can say, respondent. And these are said to be a roll number, name, age, etc. That is, they are said to be a variables or data collected on subject. Okay. So it is nothing but row column structure. 1, 2, 22, and these are the variable 1, variable 2, variable 3, variable 4, likewise. So that is what I have written here. These are the cases, that is subject, and these are the, your variable names. And if you are interested to find out the, let us say, age, you wish to extract the second column, then what should be the command? So likewise, okay. So we know that suppose if we multiply row with column, what is the output? We know that it is a 1 into 1 plus 2 into 2 plus 3 into 3. That means 1 plus 4 plus 9, it is a 14. So it is called the...
Sir, one question.
Yes, please.
Sir, one question I would like to see again, the sequencing part, which you have already done.
Okay. Let me go to the sequence again. Here, the thing is that X is, if I wish to find out, or if I wish to write a number from 1 to 10 and store into the variable X, then the command is 1 colon 10. Colon 10 means it is a spacing, it is a... just a sequence of numbers start from 1 to end and spacing is 1. But suppose if you are interested to increase the, or the changing the spacing, here it is by default, it is taking 1 to 10. Okay, so the spacing between 1 and 2 is 1, 3 and 2 is 1, likewise. But you are interested, no, I wish to have a data from 1 to 10, start from 1 and at 10, and the difference between the two number is 0.5. So I can have to use the command name is sequence. You can see that now first observation is 1, second is 1.5. Why? Because I wish a difference of a 0.5. Then third observation is 2.5, like that. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. So I came to here. So if I'm multiplying the row with the column, what I will get? I will get the scalar. I will get only one answer. But if I'm multiplying the column with row, then what is the answer? It is a matrix. Because it is a 1 cross 3. It is a 3 cross 1. And this is a 1 cross 3. That means 1 rows. Here it is a 3 rows, 1 column. So 1 into 1, what is the answer? 1. 1 into 2, answer is 2. 1 into 3 is 3. 2 1 2 2 4 2 3 6 3 1 3 3 2 6 and 3 3 9. So this is the matrix. When you multiply column with the row, it will give the matrix. So now, if you understand this basics, so that I will just switch to the R code so that you can have an idea how R is working. So I have data in A, it is a row, sorry, it is a column. B, I have taken the transpose of A, that means it is giving me the row. Now, if you multiply B with A, what happened? What should be the answer? If you row multiply with the column, we have taken the same numbers. Answer is 14. Is that?
Yes.
Okay, so let us see what is the output. Oh, it has not given 14. It is something different. What happened? It has multiplied 1 with 1, 2 with 2, and 3 with 3. So 1 with 1 means 1 square, 2 means 2 with 4, and 3 into 3 is 9. So it has made the element-wise multiplication. So when you have to be remember, when you go for the matrix multiplication, you cannot use that asterisk sign. It is only for the scalar multiplication or element-wise multiplication. But if you wish to go for the matrix multiplication, then the operator is percentage star percentage A. Operator for matrix multiplication is a percentage star percentage. Okay, let us see. Oh, now it is giving 36. Why?
Sir,
yes,
sir, I have one question, sir. I think we are multiplying B with A, right? So that means. I am talking about that.
So everyone is alert. Very good. Thank you. So answer is B. So if you multiply B with A, what was the answer? It was a 14. You can see here. So why earlier it was the wrong answer? Because I have used the star. Star is a strict sign, is mainly useful for a element wise multiplication. But when you go for the matrix multiplication, the operator is percentage star percentage. Okay. Not necessary that everyone need it. Okay. But if you know this, sometimes whenever you require, you can use it. Okay. If I'm multiplying A with B, then what happened? It should give me the column multiply row. It should give me the matrix. So what is the output? It is giving the matrix 1, 2, 3, 2, 4, 6, 3, 6, 9. Same we have obtained here. Okay. So this is about the matrix multiplication. But suppose if you are interested to find out the determinant of matrix. So the command name is a determinant and matrix is E. The answer is 0. Why? Because the rows and columns are dependent on each. If you wish to find out the eigenvalues, you may not be knowing, everyone is not knowing about the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. But when you go for the principal component analysis, there is a role of eigenvalues. Okay. So if you wish to find out the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this, you can easily find. So this is giving the eigenvalues and this is giving the eigenvectors. Okay. Now, let me see one or two examples associated with the graphical measures. Here I will also see that. Let us E kya hai? E is a matrix. Suppose I wish to extract the, let us say, second column. Then what should be the code? E square bracket comma 2. It is giving me the second column. You can see that 2, 4, 6. Okay, here the rows and columns are same. If you give E comma 2, 2, it is giving it. Suppose if you are interested to extract this only, then what should be argument? It is the element of the first row and second column. So how will you write? E 1 comma 2. So let us see what happened. E 1 comma 2. It is giving me the 2. Okay. Or if I'm writing E 3 comma 3, then it should be answer is 9. So this is the use of the square bracket. If I wish to extract the specific row or column, I can use, but make sure that if I wish to extract the column, then I have to write this where the particular matrix is stored. The matrix is stored at the variable E, then square bracket comma 2, it is extracting the second column. Okay. Is that clear up to here?
So everyone? May I ask a simple question, sir?
Yeah, please.
Hello. Yeah, sir, I'm not getting this calculation at the that console. That result is not coming here, sir. Hello?
Result is not coming in a console.
So, basically, they are, it is also showing the just the equations, and the result is right-hand side, a global environment, values.
It is better. To, can you?
I'm using Windows 7. Yes, sir.
Okay. There is no issue. Windows 7, Windows 10. There is no issue. But whether you have installed the 32 bits or 64 bits as per your that you have verified.
So 32 bit.
Okay.
So are you able to see that?
No, I'm not. First, I have to stop my presentation, then I can see. Yes, you can share now your screen.
I don't think it's coming, sir.
Presented your screen? No, yes. It is only, Manish Kumar is only one. Manish Kumar, yes. So I'm not getting your on the screen.
What's happening, sir? It's like just showing the in the console. It's just showing the formulas once again. And the values are coming on the environment. This thing.
So you can type.
Anyway, sir, I'll again go through what you.
But is there any?
Yes, I'm being able to type.
Okay, but is showing any errors?
No error is showing. No.
So you have to use either Control Enter or you can use the Run command.
I'm using the Run command.
Okay, but if you can share your screen, then perhaps I can help you.
Yeah.
Oh,
yes, sir. Now I think you'll be able to see that.
Yes, I'm seeing your screen. But sir, everything is working. You just type Z1.
Yes, it's okay.
Only type Z1 into over here. Now Control Enter. You will see the output.
Okay, got it.
So,
thank you.
No, and another madam has the same problem. Madam, same problem? Bhattacharya, madam?
Yes, sir. I was having the same problem. The first thing that you taught us, it's okay. What you have done, I just have copied. The results are okay, but from that eigenvalue of E, and when you are just elaborating about that E third bracket, comma 2, that is not showing. The results are not showing.
Can you share your screen?
Actually, sir, I'm not used to it. This is for the first time. I'm just using it.
No problem, madam. If you are on your Google Meet, there is a option. I will show you my screen and then I will show you where. So not to worry. We all are here for learning.
Okay. That will be helpful, sir.
Okay, madam. Can you? Just. Can you see my screen now? Can you see?
Please wait.
Yes. Can you see my screen? This whatever I have written.
Yes, sir.
Okay, ma'am. So again, I will go to my Google Meet, and in a Google Meet, if you can see that there is an option here. Now, if you can see my screen, my cursor is scrolling over here. Can you see that you are
presenting? Actually, sir, what I am doing that I am using my mobile phone in listening to your lecture, and with the help of I have just installed it in my laptop. So I'm not doing the same device.
Okay. So of course you can. So again,
I'm trying. I just don't want to interrupt your lecture. It is so interesting. It is so informative. I'm trying. If I can, I'll show you, please.
Sure. Ma'am.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So now everyone can see my screen. Screen, especially our window.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is what I have written here, in E, what happened? A is a column vector, B is a row vector. So when we multiply column with the row, so we will get the matrix. And the operator for this is nothing but percentage star percentage. And that it is given E. But if I wish to find out the determinant, command name is a DET. When you write this and just control enter, it is giving me the determinant. If I wish to find out the eigenvalues and eigenvector, command name is eigen, E-I-G-E-N, and then suppose if you forget the command, don't worry, E-I-G-E, then automatically it will give the suggestion. The command name is eigen. Just press the tab and then give the matrix. It is giving the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. If I am interested for this, why I have written this? Because I am interested to extract the second column. So in a matrix, after comma, whatever the number it is talking about the column, the square bracket. So that is how I have given the E comma 2. But if I am interested in the first row, then square bracket 1 comma. That means before comma, whatever numbers, it is indicating the rows of a matrix. Where the matrix is stored? It is stored in a variable E. Okay? And if I am interested in a specific element, suppose the element of the first row and second column, then I have written the square bracket. 1 means first row, comma, is associated after comma, whatever number it is talking about the column. It is E12 is associated with the element of the first row and second columns. Likewise, third rows and third element is 9. Okay. Now, suppose I wish to find out the average of few numbers. Let us say I will enter the age 25, 30, and 20. Sorry, 30. Okay. Suppose this is the data with me. And if I wish to find out the mean of X, I can store into the X bar. Command name is a mean. Now I wish to find out the mean of what? A variable X, where X contain the values of the age of respondent, that is the 25, 25, 25. Now, if I type the X bar, it is giving the average age of the respondent is a 28. Is that clear? So everyone, please type with me this. Type this code.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
See, as I say that I am not in hurry for the teaching. The best way of learning is that if we do together, we always learn more. And once we get the confidence, then R is very simple. Because whatever I wish to teach, I have given the materials. You just copy and paste, you can get the output. But why we have to write, when to write, that is very important. Okay. Suppose I am interested to find out the variance. I have taken the variable name is variance X. Okay. The command name is variance and variance of X. So you can say that variance is a 7.5. So what is the standard deviation? As we all know that standard deviation is nothing but square root of variance, where the variance is stored. Variance is stored at the VARX. Okay, so I just find out the square root is a function. Square root of variance is giving the standard deviation. What is the standard deviation? It is a 2.75. Sorry, 2.738613. We all will get the same answer because we have given the same data. If somebody has the different answer, then you have to see that whether the data are as per the my screen or not. Everyone got the answer?
Yes, sir.
Yes, anyone has
sir, one question?
Yes, please.
Sir, is this programming language is similar to LaTeX program or it is the update version?
Sir, LaTeX.
Because, sir, I did.
When I did
LaTeX program, I found something similar with this program. But I am not in the same field, so
LaTeX programming is basically for the typesetting. When you wish to write a mathematical code, then you have to write the code in a LaTeX. This is the language, sir. That LaTeX is for the for a text purpose. But of course, it is a in a LaTeX code, some of the things are common. If I wish to find out the, let us say, X square likhna hai, if I wish to write, then I write X cap 2. So here, if I wish to find out X square, I can also use that X cap 2. So of course, somewhat things you can get the similar, but both are different. One is for purely typesetting, and this is for the analysis and the execution purpose.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So yeah, please. Everyone got up to the here? Okay. Suppose I wish to find out the coefficient of variation, CV. Coefficient of variation is nothing but CV. And what is the formula of CV? Anyone can suggest what is the formula of CV? Coefficient of variation. It is a standard deviation divided by mean.
Mean.
Okay, if it is for a sample, if for a population, it is a sigma upon mu into 100. So S stands for the standard deviation and X bar stands for the mean of the data and multiply by 100 if you can. So how to write this? So there are two ways. You can directly write the command. So direct command of a standard deviation is also given. It is SD. SD of X, it is giving the standard deviation. Then mean of X, it is giving the mean. But while multiplying this 100, always keep the habit of using the brackets. So what happened? I have first start the bracket. In bracket, I have written the SD by mean. Here I have not used the standard deviation and mean calculated above. I have directly used, because I know the x, why should I unnecessarily storing this? So in that way, you can also calculate. And then I have multiply by the 100. Now I can calculate the CV x print. What is the output? It is a 9.78. You can see this command. You can give the comment CV of data. In commerce especially, CV is also important for a financial data. If you wish to identify the volatility of the data, even if you wish to invest into the share market, which stock is more consistent, it is a measure of consistency. In agricultural field, it is a measure of reliability. So it is a small measure, but it has a lot of application. Is that clear up to here, everyone? Did you get the answer 9.78?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any query up to here? If no query, then we can move further. Okay, good. Thank you. Okay. Now what I do? Yes, any query? Anyone? No. Okay, thank you. Suppose this is what I have done. Suppose if the data is given into the notebook or the page, and you are entering by the.
Excuse me, sir. May I ask you one question, please?
Yes, please.
So if that the coefficient of variation of x, CVX, it is written SD by mean into 100. So instead of SD of x, if I write that SDX, and instead of mean X, if I write X bar.
Yeah, it is giving the same answer, madam. Let me check.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
X is equal to, we have given the SDX, but keep the habit of brackets, because there is a rules of board mass. I will tell you that rules. VX, same answer.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, because you have reminded me that I have to tell the concept of board mass. Okay. Sometimes people are saying it is a board mass. I used to use as a bed mass. Okay. So bed mass principles, you have to always remember while writing a program. The syntax is working that the computer always perform whatever the things are available in the brackets. Then the next precedence, the first highest precedence means whenever they will get the bracket, exponent, division, multiplication, addition, and subtraction, first they operate bracket. Then exponent, right? For example, x square, e raised to x, something like that. So then it is a exponent. Then next it is doing the division, multiplication. Both has the same precedence. Either you do the division and multiplication, both has the same. So there is no issue. Then addition and subtraction. Okay. So it can be in that way. Suppose if I wish to write this formula in the R language, what is the usual approach? Our approach is x plus y divided by x minus y. So what is actually, this is the answer. It is x plus y by x minus y. But this is correct. This is wrong, because I wish to evaluate this. But because I have written the code in this way, I am getting the output this. So the what is the best way to write? Use the brackets. So how brackets is used? Z is equal to, just make the bracket x plus y. So what happened? R first do the operation in the bracket. So first it will make the sum, then it will also do the another bracket, that is the subtraction, and then it will give the ratio. So then it is the correct answer. So make sure, because as I say that the which has the highest precedence among the addition, subtraction and division, so division, so what happen, it will do the division first, then either addition and subtraction, but it is giving the wrong answer. So that is how use always the bracket to avoid the errors, users define errors. Okay, so that is the concept of a bad mask: bracket, exponent, division, multiplication, addition and subtraction. In this way the programs are executed. It's very simple, it is not difficult that we have to remember the bad mask. Keep habit of the using the brackets, maximum errors will be minimized. Okay, now let us say if I wish to generate a data from a normal distribution, so the R has the advantage, you can directly generate the normal distribution. The command name is a R norm, R for random, NORM for normal. So how many data you wish to generate? So you can see that it is a N comma mean 0 SD1. That means I wish to generate the 100 random numbers from a normal distribution with mean 0 and 1. That means I wish to generate the 100 random numbers from a standard normal distribution. So what is the command? Command name is R norm, and it has the arguments. So first argument is that how many numbers would you like to generate, that is the size of the numbers, and what is the mean? The mean is 0 and SD is 1, that is standard deviation is 1. So in a fraction of time it will generate the 100 random numbers. You can see that. Okay, so R is so powerful, in a fraction of time it has generated. Everyone did it? So whether your data is generated,
sir, one question.
Yeah, please.
Sir, if suppose we are doing repetitive some problems one after another, and suppose I am giving one name X previously, okay, and again suppose in this case previously we given X suppose a vector, then we are creating X as a normal variable, then automatically the previous variable will be updated, right?
Yes, sir. It is super important.
Okay.
So that is why I say that as a researcher, we have to see that we should use the common, unique variable name for a unique purpose. Otherwise, what happens? It will superimpose and our entire previous calculation goes. Okay, so we have to be very careful. Okay, so if I wish to draw the histogram, we all have heard about the histogram. So if I wish to draw the histogram, the command name is HIST. And histogram of X, I wish to give the color, let us say red. So you can see that. I told you that in a plot window you can see this. So just write this code and try to see, and then I will show you this. Write this code. Here the histogram of everyone is same or different? Everyone is busy with programming. Yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Because sometimes what happens, if internet connectivity loss, we do not have idea because I am only seeing my R screen. So that is how in between I am asking the questions. Okay. And I'm just zoom it. Here there is a button of zoom. You can see that. just click on that and just click over here, so it will give the window. So this is my histogram. Because I have given the red color, so that is our red. Somebody if write the yellow, they will get the yellow. Somebody write purple, they will get the purple histogram. Okay. So you can see that this curve is symmetric. And you can see that the center of the point is almost near to zero. Why? Because the mean of the data, median of the data are zero. Okay. Suppose somebody is interested to draw the box plot. Color equal to blue. But blue is a character, so it is always given into the double quote. You can see the histogram. Sorry, box plot. In a box plot, this center line, dark line, is said to be a median. The lower line of the box is said to be first quartile. This is said to be a second quartile, and this is said to be a third quartile. And this is said to be a whisker. It is usually 1.5 times Q3 minus Q1. And if any one of the point is outside of this box and whisker, we call them as outliers. Okay. But you can see that the box is also, that the center is dividing area into the two equal parts. Box is actually equally divided. So it is showing that data comes from a symmetric distribution. But somebody said, no, sir, we wish to draw both graph together in the same window. So there is a command, partition MF row equal to C1, 2. That means the window is partitioned in such a way that it has the one row and two column. You can write this command and you can see that earlier it was showing in a single graph in a single window. Now the both the graph in a same window. Of course, there is a lectures of data visualization you have. You will see more commands of a data visualization using ggplots, but I'm just giving the basics of R over here.
So can you change the number of beans?
Number of?
Beans in the histogram?
Yeah, then you have in histogram, of course.
I mean, I got a same type of plot, but the number of beaning, I mean, the beaning is different.
The reason is, sir, it is taking by default. And because it is a random number, so we all have a different values. We are not getting the same output.
Yes.
Because my data are different than you because it is a random.
Mm-hmm.
But if you got a specific types of a beans or the division of that particularly bars, okay, so just go to the help file.
Okay.
See, one of the advantage of R is that its help is very powerful. So how to do that? Just give the help command and whatever the techniques you wish to know, if you know the command, just give it. So it has opened the help file.
Okay. Thank you.
And just click over here. You can see that breaks, you can have the various breaks are there. You can here by default the breaks are the Sturgis it has taken. Okay, so it has mentioned it is equi space breaks. Okay. there is a sturge break, there is a breaks are squats, FD. So these are the various breaks are given that you can supply, it is giving. But if you add the number of breaks, then again you have to write the code specifically, because it has given the specific purpose, specific things. Okay. So everyone has written up to here?
Yes.
Okay. So you can see that it has divided the window into the two part. Okay. The one is showing histogram, another is showing the box plot. So you can, if you wish to make it 2x2, then of course you can make the 2x2 by writing here 2, 2, 2. So it is dividing the windows into the four part. Okay. One more command I would like to discuss here. Most of the time what happens in a sampling, we can have given the population size, let us say n is equal to 100 is given. And then it is saying that you select a sample of size 10 with replacement, or simple random sampling with replacement and without replacement. So the command name is sample. And you can give the size. So let us say capital N. From which size do you wish to generate the N? And if you are by default, replace equal to false. So by default, it is giving the without replacement. This small N, this is. It is warning, there is no issue. Small N and then capital N. Why it is giving so much numbers? Oh, we have not given the capital N. By default, earlier something is written on a capital N and small N. That is how it is giving the output. So here, capital N is 100. Out of 100 unit, if I wish to select only 10 units, or out of 100 size of a class, if I wish to select 10 randomly students without replacement, then the command you can use is sample. So which numbers? So these are the numbers. These are all without replacement. But if you wish to find out the with replacement, and the command is same, you have to just write replace equal to true. You can write also capital P. There is no issue. Okay. But when you are writing the replacement equal to true, it is not always give the guarantee that the same numbers may repeat it. It may repeat or it may not repeat. So here you can see that none of the numbers is repeating in replace equal to true. Okay. So it is not necessary that if you perform the with replacement, then the same individuals may come always. That is not true. So this is the kind of a small commands we have used while selecting farmers from a specific district. Okay, so if we have given the sampling frame of a, let us say, 1,000 farmers of a specific region, and if I wish to apply the, after applying the inclusion exclusion criteria, I have, let us say, 500 farmers are there. Then out of 500, if I wish to select the 50 farmers, then we can just apply the, because sampling frame is available with us, and we can use this command and it will give the numbers. We will go to that person and collect the information. It's a small command, but it has a lot of applications. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now I will show you that suppose if you wish to write your own function. Here, okay, I will also explain one more command. Okay. Suppose x equal to, I have a c, 25, 30, 25, 30, 20. Okay. So this information is available. I wish to find out the summary of x. So what it gives? Summary gives the minimum value, first quantile, median means second quantile, mean, third quantiles, and maximum value. The summary command is always helpful to identify is there any outliers in your data or not. Suppose if some observation I have entered instead of 20, I have entered 120. Then you can see the difference between the mean and median is very large. So whenever there is a large difference between a mean and median, it is indicating that there is an outlier present in your data. Okay. And when there is an outlier present in your data, which measure of central tendency is more suitable? It is a median. And you can also see that the minimum and maximum, there is a far difference between these two observations. Okay. So summary statistics can help you to obtain at a time minimum value of the data, maximum, mean, median, first quartile, and third quartiles. The same summary command, if you go for the regression analysis, if somebody is going to discuss on regression analysis, they will use the same summary command after performing the regression models. It will give the estimate of parameters, testing of parameters, everything. Same summary command. But if your arguments are different, the role is different. Here argument is only the numbers are given, it means that the summary command gives the minimum, maximum, first quartile, second quartile, median and third quartiles, or the mean and third quartiles. Okay. Suppose I hope everyone has done this.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Suppose you wish to write your own command. For example, I wish to calculate z is equal to x square plus y square. I have given the data of x. I have given the data of y. So I wish to calculate this z based on this relation. But such function is not directly available in the R. Then you have to write your user-defined function. I told you, you can define various function, user-defined function. So that means you can write your own function. So how to write, I will show you. Is that okay? My objective is that I have given the value of x and y. I do not have given this. Okay. So I wish to evaluate this. So how to evaluate this? So that we will calculate. So what is given? X. Suppose x, if I am taking minus phi to phi, we will print so that we can have the idea. Okay. So it starts from minus phi to minus 1, then 0, 1 to phi. And y is also a, let us say, minus phi to phi. Number of observations should be same. But how many observation in the x? How many in x and how many in y? Anyone suggest? How many observation in x and how many observation in y?
So 11 observations.
11, sir. 11.
So 11. Everyone has counted from minus 5 to 5. So that means minus 5 to minus 1, that is 5, 0, and then 5. Okay. So if you have a large data set, then perhaps it is difficult to count. So what happened? We can use the command length of x. Answer is 11. Length of y. Answer is 11. So a small command. which can help you to identify the number of cases in your study. Suppose some observation are missing, it is also saying that some observation are missing, then how many observations are there. Okay, so length command can be useful. Okay, now my objective is that I wish to write a function. Whenever you wish to write a function, how to write? Z is equal to function. How many argument? I wish to supply two argument, x and y. Then curly braces. What calculation I wish to make? X square plus y square. Okay, one of the sir has asked me the LaTeX code. So you can, in LaTeX we are writing usually x cap 2, that means x square, and y cap 2. Okay, so this is my user defined function. Okay. If I supply the x comma y, where the variable is, function is written, it is written in z. And what are the arguments? Two arguments. You can see that z minus phi into minus phi. Minus phi square is 25. Minus phi square is 25. 25 plus 25 is 50. Minus 4 square is 16. Plus 16, 32. Okay, so this is your defined function, user defined. It's very simple. I told you that we can write the curly braces while using the our user defined function, even for a for loop and others. Everyone just try. Okay, everyone has done?
Yes, sir.
Anyone has any query up to this? Then we will see the one for loop and then we will stop the introduction to R. And I will explain you how to import the data from Excel to R and Notepad to R, because I have shared you the many data files. So that import export facility we will see at the time of using the files. Okay, it is just beginning. In introduction to R there are many things you can cover. There are infinite number of functions are there, but ultimately thing is that we should know the basic. That is very important. I will explain you the for loop. If I have write the x 1 to 10, what is the output? It is a sequence of numbers where x takes value 1 to 10. So what is the sum of x? It is a 55. Okay, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus, sum is itself is a command. Sum of the given numbers. So 1 to 10, it is a sum of 10 integer numbers. So we know the formula. If you remember the 10th standard or the 7th standard, if I wish to find out the sum of 1 plus 2 plus n, then the formula is n into n plus 1 by 2. In our setup, x takes value 1 to 10, it means n equal to 10. So 10 into 10 plus 1 by 2, that is 10 into 11 by 2, it is equal to 55. Okay, so we have obtained the 55 using the sum command. Now, if I wish to find out the sum of this, using the for loop, then can we for I. I is index with text value 1 to 10. In 1 to 10. I text value 1 to 10. Then initially I will give here sum equal to 0. Capital S here. Initially sum equal to 0. Then I will write here sum plus sum equal to sum plus I. Let us see what output we have. This 55. I will explain you this how it is working. So initially I have assigned sum is a variable. Here the small sum is a function. I have used here the capital. Avoid the habit of using the small letters, especially variable name, while writing the R code. So here sum equal to 0. Initially sum has the value 0. When here what happened, I takes value 1 to 10. First I takes 1, then 2, 3, up to how many, how up to how it reach, it is a 10. So when you take I equal to 1, so initially sum equal to 0, 0 plus 1 is assigned to the sum. So now sum become, new sum is a 1. Then I become the 2, then this new sum has the 1, 1 plus 2 is 3. So now sum become the 3. Then here 3 plus 4, it is a 7, 7 plus 5, 12, likewise. Because every time we are changing the value of a sum by replacement. So this is the use of a for loop. Everyone please try. So this kind of the programming you can also do when you require. This also possible. Here this is the just ready-made command base I have done, and then I have said that okay, now I don't want to do the based on command. I wish to write the using the for loop. So this is called the programming. This is not in that way programming, it is a command base output. Okay, this is actually a programming. But many times user, especially a core researcher, require the need of a programming. Otherwise, most of the time you can get the output based on the inbuilt commands are there. Okay. If you wish to perform the cluster analysis, there are commands there. If you wish to perform factor regression, only if you write the 6 to 7 line of a commands, you have the entire output, which you are getting through commercial version by clicking manual driven software. Here it is not a manual driven, still people are working on that. R Commander is a kind of a software which is based on menu driven. So R Commander is there. Is that clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Any questions till far?
No, sir.
I'm getting only answer from two. According to the voice analysis. What about others?
No.
No, no sir.
Samajh mein nahi aaya ki samajh mein aaya? Okay, no problem, no question.
No problem, sir.
Okay, no problem, good. Sir.
So that means we are not fast. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Speed is fine, sir.
Okay, good. So tomorrow also we will have the same speed, so not to worry. Okay, so I think I can stop for the introduction to R, and then I will now switch over to the basics of the statistics, and then we will jump into the parametric and non-parametric. Dayashankar sir, are we need to give a break of 5 minutes? Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So, can we have a break of 5 minutes and then again I will start?
Sure, sir.
Okay. So, let us take this liberty. We'll take a 5 minutes break and again, in my watch, it is a 16:56, 4:56. Okay, so we will again start.
Five minutes break, sir.
5 minutes?
Yes.
5 minute break, sir.
Okay.
Is it fine, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So, within a 5 minutes, again, we will assemble.
Okay.
Thank you. So I came back shortly. Let us wait 2 minutes more for others to come back.
No problem, sir.
Okay, sir, should I start? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You can start.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay, so in the first lecture, we discuss about the introduction of R, in which we have seen that how to open the R in R Studio, and we have also seen that how to write a particular name of the variables. So name of the variables are nothing but it is always begin with the alphabets followed by the numerals and some special characters. No space is allowed. Then we have seen the concept of the operation of assignment, that means the assignment operators we have seen. Then we have performed the basic arithmetic operators. We have also seen that how to clear the screen using the control L, and to run the commands we have to use the control enter. Then we discuss about the how to enter the vectors using the keyboard. Then we have performed the some matrix operations, scalar operations. Then we have extracted the rows and columns of the matrix as well as the cell of a matrix. Then we calculate the determinants of the data, eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the data. Then we go for the generation of a sequence of a numbers using the colon operators and using the sequence command. Then we calculate the mean and variance and standard deviation of a given data. We calculate the CV based on that. We discuss about the Bode-Mas principles. And later on, we generated the data, 100 random numbers from a normal distribution. We make the histogram, we make the box plot. And also we have seen the command of how to partition the window for the in a one graph paper if you wish to plot the two windows by using the PR command. Then we discuss about the how to go with the user defined functions. And after user defined functions, we have used the application of a for loop and how to write a for loop. So this is the small introduction which I have given in the R. After that, now we will discuss about the testing of hypothesis. In testing of hypothesis, there are two tests, especially there are two parts. One is a parametric test and a second one is a non-parametric test. Okay, so before going to that, see, as a statistician, we are getting the information from a non-statistician, or usually non-statisticians are getting the problem related to the statistics, then they come to the statistic department. And while discussion with them, I realized that some presentation which should be useful for a statistician as well as the non-statistician. So having heard from many non-statisticians while analyzing their data, they are facing lots of difficulties due to the lack of knowledge in the field of statistics. Of course, they are non-statisticians, so they must have the lesser knowledge compared to the statistician, and they are getting the problem of analyzing the data, or they are not capable to analyze it with the proper techniques and confidence. Either they have the less knowledge, or maybe they have not a basic idea of the statistics, so they could not able to analyze it. Also, there are no such books available which can guide and cover all possible techniques for data analysis with proper logic, theoretical as well as computational, through different software package for a non-statistician. The statistics books are a lot of written, so many examples are given, and the programming and the software books are given, but it is not of a kind of a sandwich that this some mathematical jargon of statistics is given, and then after explaining this mathematics, how to analyze using the softwares based on the certain data. So that is not discussed. So in this presentation, I'll try to present a brief survey of on such statistical modeling technique with respect to the nature of data. Well, I'm not going to discuss all, but few techniques on them. Also try to explain appropriate method which is applicable under different situation. Most of the time what happen, we know the software, because today you have learned the R language, tomorrow we'll start analyzing your data. So R, you just supply the numbers, R will give the output. But whether this output is important for you or not, whether the whatever the techniques you have selected, it is appropriate or not, that you have to first identify. Okay, so that is very important that you should understand the nature of data, because most of the time the statistical techniques has been developed based on the nature of the data. We call them as a measurement of scaling of data. And we will also try to explain you that which technique should be applicable under which situation. So this presentation is classified with respect to measurement level of response and explanatory variables and corresponding technique, possibly by demonstrating with R language. So in this presentation, we will discuss about the scale of measurements, and then what are the basic statistical techniques should be used for according to the nature of data. Then we will see the few non-parametric tests like test of independence and goodness of fit of distributions. And then we major discuss about the testing and non-parametric tests, this many. And if time permit, we will also take the ANOVA and two-way ANOVA. Okay. So, statistics has its own vocabulary. If I'm asking you, how many have the knowledge of statistics? All participants have the knowledge of statistics? Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So everyone has studied the statistics at either their graduation level or post-graduation level or during the research. Anyone is there who has no information of statistics? No, that means everyone are comfortable. Okay, but most of the time what happened, the people are saying that we don't know statistics. So usually that is how I used to say that statistics has its own vocabulary. Many of the terms that comprise statistical nomenclatures are familiar. Some commonly used in everyday language like sample. So we use in day-to-day life sample, proportion, average. So these are nothing but the statistics. Statistics is a science of decision making, because whatever the decision we are taking, it is based on the some scientific methods, and the decision is based on the data driven. So statistics is a science of a decision making, and decision should be taken based on the availability of the data. Now the question is that what do you mean by the data? So we know that data is a collection of information, and the information may be of a two type. It may be of a quantitative or it may be of a qualitative. If I'm talking with you, so we are generating the qualitative information. If we do the some collection of the facts and figures, then it is a quantitative information. So usually data usually classified into the two part. One is a quantitative and second one is a qualitative. So what do you mean by the qualitative data? A data which cannot measure through physical measurement, scale, or another word, attribute data, are said to be a qualitative data. In short, if no physical measurement tool is there to measure the data, then such data is said to be a qualitative data. If you do not have a such, okay. So for example, if I wish to measure the eye color, can we measure? If I wish to measure the types of injury, it is a perception of a doctor, whether the injury is high, low, or medium. The genders, whether the male, female, or transgenders. So what I mean to tell you that when there is no physical measurement tool is there to measure data, then such data is said to be a qualitative data. And qualitative data are classified into the two parts. One is nominal, second one is ordinal. So what is nominal data? It is simply a label which can help you to identify or classify the object. For example, your name. So your name is identifying you. Your social security numbers, your passport numbers. It is nothing but it is simply a label to identify the individuals. Okay, so common examples are the, let us say, gender, whether the male or female, subject numbers, unique patient IDs. So these are the common examples of a nominal data. It means whenever you have simply a label to identify the object, then such data is said to be a nominal. Okay, whether you are belong to the West Bengal, whether you are belong to the UP, whether you are belong to the Gujarat, it is nothing but it is simply a label to identify that where the respondents come from. So such kind of a data is said to be a nominal data. If some new movie is broadcast on an OTT platform, whether do you like the movie or not? So liking or disliking, it is also, if you like the movie, yes. If you dislike the movie, okay. So it is nothing but again a simply a label to identify the object, whether the how many people like the movie, how many people do not like the movie, what percentage of the people like the movie, what percentage of people did not dislike the movie, and who is maximum. So such data are the nominal and common summary statistics. You can use the frequency, percentage, and more. But if you add one property of ordering in the nominal data, then such data is said to be a ordinal data. So a label which can help to identify or classify object, as well as the magnitude of ordering property associated with categories, such data is said to be a ordinal data. For example, if there is an accident or happened in some crossing and the ambulance has taken the patient to the hospital, doctor will decide the types of injury, whether it is a low, moderate, or high. Okay, so it is an injury. It has identification, whether low, moderate, high. But there is a connection between the category. It is a magnitude ordering property. Types of cancer, preference of selection of doctors. If you have given the 5 doctors are there, out of 5, which doctors will you prefer first? Which prefer second, third, fourth? Even the selection of hospitals, selection of a mobile phones, okay, selection of a partners. Suppose the 5 partners are identified, you have shortlisted. Now, which you give the first priority? So these are all nothing but example of a ordinal data. And these are nothing but the members of a qualitative data. Now, earlier I say that if there is no physical measurement tool is there to measure the data, then they are said to be a qualitative. But if you have some measurement tool are there, or you can say that if data can be quantified, then such data is said to be a quantified. For example, if I wish to measure the height of respondent, I have a measure tape. If I wish to measure the weight, then I have a weighing machine. If I wish to measure the blood sugar level, cholesterol level, so I have some instruments are there to measure the data. So such data is said to be a quantitative data. And whenever you have a quantitative data, it is classified into the 2 part, either interval or ratio. So again, you can see that first data was the nominal. It is simply identify the object. Okay. But if you add the property, it becomes the ordinal. So in gradually after nominal, there is ordinal data and there is a interval and then there is a ratio. So the development of the scale is also in a such fashion. So in interval data, the difference between the consecutive categories known and equal, then such data is said to be a interval data. For example, if you are measuring the information on a 5-point scaling at the end of the seminar or workshop, you have been asked, you rate the faculty on a 1 to 5 scaling. Okay, 1 means worst and 5 means very good. And 3 means neutral. It has been asked you to rate the faculty in a 5-point scaling. Now everybody has their own perception. Okay, if you understand, you will give the higher rate. If you do not understand what the speaker would like to convey, then you give the lower rating. Okay, so that perception is vary from person to person. So we measure them in a Likert scale. Sometimes we call that it is a 5-point scaling. So whenever such data are measured, we can see that the difference between the 1 and 2 is same as the difference between the 3 and 4 and 4 and 5. It is not saying that the perception level, the exaggeration reaching. The difference between the 2 categories is known and equal, then such data is said to be interval data. And the satisfaction measured on a 5-point scaling is a classical example of that. But the interval data has this demerit. 0 is arbitrary. For example, if you say that the today temperature is a 0 degree, will you say that there is no temperature? Will you say that there is no temperature?
No.
We cannot, because zero is not absolute zero. You can measure on a different measurement of scale. You can measure either in a Fahrenheit or you can measure in a Kelvin. So it means that zero is not fixed. Okay. So such data is said to be a. So that is how you are looking for a new scale where the zero is absolutely zero. Even another example, you can say that if you take about the IQ test, in a one exam, the student got the 100 out of 100. Then can you say that IQ is 100? In the second exam, the student got 100 out of 0. So can you say that his IQ becomes 0? No. So whenever such situations are there, at that time, we need to go with the specific kind of a data, which is called the ratio, where the absolute zero means absolute zero. So zero means zero. And it satisfies all the properties of the previous scale. For example, height of the respondent is zero means zero. Weight of the respondent is zero means zero. Okay. Yeah, weight of the any product is zero. So that means zero. Okay. So such data is said to be a ratio data. So mainly why this classification is very important, because most of the statistical techniques have been developed around to this measurement of scale. The precaution is required before analyzing of any data given to us. Before analyzing, one has to first check the nature of data, whether it is qualitative or it is a quantitative. The reason, because most of the statistical techniques developed with respect to measurement of scale, you cannot perform the t-test ANOVA for a qualitative response. When you perform the t-test or analysis of variance, the response must be quantitative. It should not be qualitative. It is applicable only for the response measured on a quantitative scale. But most of the time, what happened? The data, people have the data and they are trying to compare. Okay, sir, we wish to apply the t-test for the whether the average liking of the movie and average disliking of the movie are same or not. Okay, because the softwares are there, sir. We have click and we get the output. We know the R and we have analyzed. Are you getting my point? Don't directly jump to analyze the data without assessing whether the technique is suitable or not. Software can minimize your efforts of analyzing the data, but your responsibility becomes the higher. Because if you just click and get the output, you may at the end of the day come with the wrong output, okay, and which has no meaning of interpretation. One more example I would like to tell. Suppose if I wish to measure my objective average family size, I wish to find out the average family size of the respondent. Okay. So if I wish to measure this average family size, what is my variable of interest? Anyone? My objective is that I wish to find out average family size. Am I audible?
Number of members in the family.
Yes, very good. That means my interest variable is family size. That means how many members are staying in your family. Okay. Somebody said 3, somebody said 5, somebody said 7, somebody said 2. Likewise, somebody said, no, I'm alone. And my objective is that I wish to find out the average. These are the data are available. Then which average I can prefer? Should I use mean? Should I use mode? Should I use median? Which?
Mean.
Which mean?
It should be mean.
Okay. Any other? See, one of the lady has said that we can use the mean as a measure of central tendency, because there are 3 measure of central tendency: mean, median, and mode. So which, because I have been asked.
Maybe median.
Yes. please.
Mean, maybe median two.
Maybe median, no, not maybe. You have to be come with anyone, either mean or median.
Mean is perfect.
Mean. Okay, so I think most of the people have the answer is mean. Okay, and that is how I say that I hope everyone has understand or the studied the statistics at their graduation other thing. Okay, so when you find out the mean, suppose the mean turns out to be 27.75, because mean is nothing but the sum of observation divided by the number of observation, and suppose the answer is 2.75, then what is the interpretation?
The average family size is 2.75 members, which is not possible for a family.
Yes, it is not possible. So whenever we use the statistical techniques, we always try to see that whether the interpretation of its output is feasible or not. So can we apply the median? In median also possible that if we arrange the data in ascending order and the center value, suppose if it is even numbers, so it is a sum of two numbers and divides average of two numbers, middle number. So again, it may chance that it comes down to be a fractional value. So in that setup, the mode is suitable. Which number is repeated more often time? Okay. For example, if you are manufacturing the shoes, so if you are collecting which shoes I should produce, so you collected the data of the how many are wearing the 5 numbers, 4 numbers, 7 numbers, and then you said, sir, average size of the shoes is required is 6.5. which is not suitable to anyone. So then you have to see that which numbers mode are more repeated occurs. So that means the mode is a measure of central tendency. So what I mean to tell you that whenever the data comes to you, you should first ask what is the nature of variable. Now after nature of variable, you decide which statistical technique is possible. Now whatever the statistical technique you have identified, do we have the feasible interpretation at the end of analysis? That question we have to ask ourselves, and if yes, then whatever statistical techniques we have used, it is suitable. Most of time, if you remember this table, yes, please.
Sir, in the case of this family size question, if we use mode, so can we like we can say that this mode is the correct representation of the analysis? Like we are asking about average.
Yes.
And if there is only two maximum number, like 7 is twice and all has given one number. So 7 is the answer, that average family size is 7. So is it the correct representation of the analysis?
No, everyone has given the, suppose the, here maximum number is not the mode. Here which number is repeated more often. Suppose everyone has given the 111, then maximum family has the one person is living in their family. So then it is a suitable measure.
Okay, okay. Thank you.
Okay. If you remember these tables, this is the measurement of scale, nominal ordinal interval ratio, and some common examples are given. Gender is the example, whether the male or female, patient numbers. So these are the common example of nominal. As I say that how many male have participated in survey, how many female have participated, it is a frequency. What percentage of male have participated, what percentage of female, then it is a percentage, and who is maximum, then more. So if you have a nominal data, you can use frequency, percentage and more, and corresponding inferential statistics like a binomial test and chi-square test. We will discuss binomial test and chi-square test at detail using the R, not mathematically, using the R. And when your data is ordinal, so common example I have given, types of injury, preference of rating. So because ordinal data, so some rank is associated. So that is how you can use the median as well as the percentile. So all non-parametric tests are ultimately converting your data into the ordinal structure, and then they are using the median as a measure of central tendency. Then you can have the common core inferential statistics. You can use the Spearman correlation, rank correlation, Kruskal-Wallis test, which is an alternative to the one-way ANOVA, Friedman test, which is alternative to the two-way ANOVA. If your data is interval, common example is satisfaction measured on a 5-point scale. Okay, you can use mean, variance, standard deviation, geometric mean, standard deviation. This geometric mean and harmonic mean, especially for ratio. But for a ratio scale, you can use the above descriptive statistics as per your requirement. Suppose you're, as I said, that you are interested to calculate the BMI. Okay, the BMI, you have a data of height and weight. You can calculate the BMI, but now you wish to go for the classification of obesity. So convert this raw data into the group data, and then you can convert them into the nominal ordinal, and you can use the above descriptive statistics. So if you have this interval, you can use t-test, ANOVA, regression, analysis, etc. And ratio data.
Sir, yes. Sir, can the satisfaction measure on 5-point scale can be considered as ordinal? Because
people are considering a 2-aspect.
Okay.
Many of the researchers are also saying that as an ordinal.
Okay. Yeah.
They are calculating the frequency and then they perform the cross tabulation.
That's right, sir.
But satisfaction level measured on a 5-point scaling, it is a scale you have defined. So purely in that way, you can see that it is a part of a interval scale, because the difference between the 1 and 2 is same as the difference between 2 and 3.
Yeah.
Satisfy the property of interval scale. So we use them as a quantitative data, and then we perform. Even when you come to the factor analysis, the most of the times researcher will give the data of market research which are measured on the 5-point scaling. So
they all right,
factor analysis.
Okay,
people can use if you wish to find out that how many have given the rating of 1, 2. But what I advise, whenever you have a data on a 5-point scaling, convert them into the 3-point scaling.
All right.
Like low, moderate,
and high.
And high. And how to convert? Based on the quantiles. So whatever the data you have, just calculate the quantiles. Let us say X is your data. So if X is less than or equal to Q1, assign them as a low. Q1 matlab first quantiles. Then if X is lies between Q1 and Q3, then assign them as a moderate. This is the scientific way. And if X is greater than Q3, then assign them as a, here less than equal to.
Okay, so you are saying about the range to be considered in this case.
No, sir, if you wish to go for the converting the data into the ordinal scale, usually what happens, people have the habit that they are saying 1 and 2, assign them as a low, 3 assign as a moderate, and 4 and 5 as assign them as a high. So it is a wrong practice. So I advise that whenever you have a data on a 5-point scaling, and if you wish to perform some ordinal analysis, then you can convert using the quantiles. The quantiles summary mein nikala na humne. In summary, quantile, second quantile, third quantile. It is giving the some value.
Okay.
It is kind of that. If you go
graphically. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. I have a query. One more. I had a query, sir. सर अगर हम वो पॉवर्टी के डेटा का मेजर कर रहे हैं तो विच लाइक बिलो पॉवर्टी लाइन एंड अबव पॉवर्टी लाइन तो कौन सी स्केल एप्ट होगी सर फॉर मेजरमेंट लाइक इंटरवल स्केल रेशियो स्केल
ओनली यू हैव द डेटा ऑफ
पॉवर्टी
इट इज अ डेटा फॉर एग्जांपल यू हैव असाइंड द थ्रेशोल्ड पॉइंट लेट अस से दिस इज द पॉवर्टी लेवल ओके And if you have just converted into the categorical form, that means that how many people below this and how many above this, then it is the nominal data. Then you always find out the frequency. Okay, how many are below the poverty? What percentage of the people in India or in a state below the poverty line? Okay. But if you have the raw data, income data is available, then it is a ratio data. Because you have pure income is available. So that is what I said. Now, if you have the BMI, if you convert the BMI into the, whether the it has the low BMI, normal or the obesity, so you are converting them into the 3-point scaling. Okay. So based on the range. So this become the ordinal.
Sir, can it any way, it can be intervals, can it be measured on an interval scale?
40 line?
In what? Yes, sir.
But interval scale, how?
So that is the question. Actually, sir, मैं आपको इसलिए पूछ रही हूँ because we were asked these questions on multiple choice questions. So I had answered ratio scale. So for me, I think it was the best on like the apt the characteristics of the scale which most fulfilled this criteria on poverty was the ratio scale. But the right answer they pointed out, the examiners, they say that it is the interval scale. But I tried to convince them. I gave certain arguments like you are putting through. But they're saying the right answer is the interval scale. But nowhere I am convinced that it should be interval scale.
But if I'm saying that poverty is zero means zero.
Yeah, I mean, because zero is the absolute value, which has some meaning, significance, right?
Then it should be...
Right. So it cannot, because in interval scale, zero is assumed arbitrarily, just in temperature example you gave, right?
Yes.
So my logic is that it should be measured in ratio scale, but the examiners, they deducted my 4 marks because of that thing. So
it depends. So not to worry. Okay. If our logics are clear and we are thorough with
this, I think yes, sir, because I argued that in the group also, like how can it be like interval scale? So the 4 marks which has been deducted, it is a wrong deduction.
Are they able to convince you why they are in interval?
No, sir.
That means you are correct.
I'm correct, sir. That was the only question I got it wrong. Okay, sir. Thank you. That's why I was just cross verifying with you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. So earlier the question was that I was just talking about. If you have this normal bell-shaped curve, you have this first quantile, second quantile, and third quantiles. So 25% of observation is always less than the first quantile. 25% are always lies between the first and second. 25% in second and third, and 25% in the above the third. So I will say that assign them as a low. Assign them as a high, and assign them as a moderate. Because low and high are always in extreme, and most of the data are in the central part. So that is how this is the one of the scientific way to convert your 5-point scaling data into the 3-point scaling. And most of the time, I always advise the researcher, if possible, try to collect the information on 5-point scaling. You can later on convert them into the 2-point scaling and 3-point scaling. If you less than the Q2 and above the Q2, the data is 2-point scaling. So that can be possible. Okay. Now, this is all associated with the univariate analysis, but when you have the kind of a two types of variables, let us say y and x, where y is a dependent variable, x is an independent variable, y may be continuous, y may be a qualitative. For example, response you have, the y is whether the patient is cured or not. Okay, whether you will get the success or failure, these are all the response. So which technique is suitable when your data is of a both y and x are qualitative, y and x are quantitative? So usual setup, we have studied the equation of line in our 10th standard. Okay, and that is if we convert little bit from this, we write this as a regression line. Y is a dependent variable, x is an independent. Beta 0 and beta 1 are parameters, and epsilon is nothing but the random errors. And it is a cumulative effect of all other variables which we have not considered for our study. Okay. So now, based on the nature of this variable, the techniques is identified. Suppose y is a quantitative and x is a quantitative. Which technique is possible? Y is a quantitative, x is a qualitative, which model should be used? Y is a qualitative, x is a qualitative, which model should be used? So that is how I have given this small table, which can help you. Your dependent variable is, this is y, this is your x. X can be single x or it can be multiple x. So y is a continuous and x is a continuous. Then you can apply the regression theory. Okay. Then it may be a linear regression, multiple linear regression, non-linear regression. It can be any, but you can apply the regression theory. If y is of a categorical, for example, the patient is survived or not, or you can say that the customer is churn or not, okay, or whether economy is going to grow or not. So when the response is binary, or okay, when response is a binary and X is a continuous, you can apply the logistic regression. If Y is a continuous and X is a categorical, you can apply the analysis of variance. If you wish to compare the average salary of the three groups or the three region, so the salaries are in the continuous variable and groups or the region are in a categorical variable, we can use the analysis of variance. If Y and X both are categorical, we use the modeling as a log linear models. Otherwise, we have used the chi-square contingency table test. Okay, is there any association between two attributes or not? But if you wish to develop the models, there is a model called log linear models. If Y is a continuous, X is both continuous and categorical, then you can use the analysis of covariance. If Y is a categorical, X is both, then still you can use the logistic regression. In both the case, you can apply the logistic regressions. Okay, so what I mean to tell you, if you study the nature of variables, you can first identify the right technique. Then you should understand what is the theory about. Then you write the code and you get can come with the output. But most of the time, what happens? People will the regression theory, whether it is a continuous or categorical. So that is how we are getting the wrong result and the things. Is there any clear up to this? Any questions? Any doubts? Yes, anyone? Hello, any doubts? Anyone?
No, sir.
Daya, sir?
Yes, sir.
So you have to tell me where to stop. Otherwise, I will start continuing the next part.
सर ये आप पर डिपेंड करता है,
है? ओके
ये आप पर डिपेंड करता है पढ़ने वाले हैं पढ़ाने वाले हैं बस मैं तो बैठा हूँ चुपचाप सर
ओके सो आई विल टेक दिस वन टेस्ट ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ ऑर्डर्स एंड देन रेस्ट ऑफ द थिंग्स वी विल टेक दी टुमारो ओके सो व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट द टेस्टिंग ऑफ हाइपोथेसिस In testing of hypothesis, basically a two-part. It is divided into the parametric test and non-parametric. Okay. Now the question is that what do you mean by the hypothesis? So hypothesis is nothing but we statistician we denote as a H0. Hypothesis is nothing but it is a simply a guess or assertion. Okay, about of your study, it is a guess. Okay, so usually the null hypothesis is that should be framed in a such a way that which has maximum chance of rejection. So we are not interested in the null hypothesis, we are interested in the alternative hypothesis. So the null hypothesis should be framed in a such a way that which has a possible chance of rejection, because we are interested in the alternative. H1 is tends called the alternative. This is called null. This is called alternative. Okay. For example, we say that the product, if there's some production process is going on, we say that the lot is of good quality. If I am keeping this hypothesis, if the null hypothesis is accepted, I am very happy. Lot is of a good quality, but I am not interested in the lot is of good quality. I am interested in that lot is of inferior quality. Why? Because एज ए इंडस्ट्री आई विश टू सी दैट देयर शुड नॉट बी एनी कंप्लेंट फ्रॉम द कस्टमर साइड. सो बिफोर सेंडिंग माई प्रोडक्ट इन टू द मार्केट आई विल सी दैट whether the lot is appropriate or not. If it is not, then what kind of the remedial measures I have to take so that I can improve the quality of lot. So most of the times we are not interested in the null hypothesis, we are interested in the alternative. And when you talk about the hypothesis, you will always take the two types of errors. Two errors are there. One is type one. Another is a type 2. Type 1 means reject at not. Reject at not when at not is true. That means lot is of a good quality. At not is true means lot is of a good quality. But due to the sampling, I say that reject the lot. So it is a error. Achha hai, usko aapne reject kar diya. Then type 2 is accept at not when it is given that H1 is true. When you know that H1 is true, that means at not is not correct and you are accepting. If the lot is of a not good quality and still you are accepting, so this is another type of errors. And the probability of type 1 error is known as alpha. And beta is nothing but probability of type 2 error. In terms of the quality assurance, we call them as a producer risk. Lot is of a good quality, still you are rejecting, so we suffer our producer. And type 2 error is a consumer risk. Lot is of a bad quality, but due to the sampling you have to accept and it will send in the market, we will suffer consumer. So there are two types of errors, type 1 and type errors, and you cannot minimize both the errors together, and that is how you are fixing one error. So you are fixing the probability of type 1 errors and try to minimize probability of type 2 errors. So type 1 error is nothing but our level of significance. Usually we say that test this hypothesis at 5% level of significance. So alpha is equal to 0.05. Test at the 1% level of significance. That means alpha equal to 0.01. That means we can allow the 5% errors in our decision. That means what is the confidence? The confidence is a 1 minus alpha percentage into 100%. That means 1 minus 0.05 into 100%, it means it is a 95%. So we say that there is a confidence of 95% about the decision about this hypothesis. Okay. So while performing any testing of hypothesis, you should know the test statistics, whether it is a one sample t-test, independent sample t-test, pair t-test, Wilcoxon sign test. Okay. So we should know the test statistics and then we should find the distribution of a test statistic. Level of significance, that is this alpha, and we have to decide the rules whether the lot should be accepted or rejected. Okay, so whenever you talk about the testing of hypothesis, I say that parametric test, that means we should have the information about distribution of data. If you have heard about the normal distribution or Gaussian distribution, if we say that the response follow the normal distribution, that means we should know the distribution. And distribution is nothing but it is to identifying the patterns in the data. If the distribution is symmetric, then most of the data are centered around a specific value, positive skewed, negative skewed. So it is all about the identifying the nature of the data, and that can be characterized by the distribution. If you know the distribution, then you should always go for the parametric test. And if the distribution of data is unknown, take the sum transformation and convert into the suitable distribution, then perform parametric. If it is not possible to know, then you should try to go for the non-parametric test. So when you perform the parametric test, it has a certain assumption. If any one of the assumption is violated, try to transform the data and see that transform data follows the specific assumption or not. If not, then perform the non-parametric. So one of the tests in statistics, you always try to see that whether the data is random or not. Why random? Data is normally distributed. These are mainly two assumptions we always try to see. Why random? Anyone? Why we always check randomness?
Sir, otherwise the results will be biased.
Yes, exactly, sir. If we do not have the data is of a random in nature, then we cannot represent. We cannot say that whatever the data we have taken, they are the representative of a population. For example, in social survey, most of the time you are doing the sampling, purposive sampling, non-probability sampling schemes you are using for the collecting the data. But whatever results you are getting, that is true for the only that sample. You cannot generalize when you are going for the non-probability sampling scheme. And that is how in statistics, probability sampling designs are there. One can go for the simple random sampling, stratified random sampling, systematic sampling, cluster sampling, two-phase sampling, double-phase sampling, likewise. Okay, two-stage sampling. So there are various sampling designs are available where the precaution is there that whatever the samples we have taken, it is a true representative of a population. So that is how we always try said, when I am saying that true representative, it means that data comes randomly. There is no bias, as sir has rightly said. Okay, so there is no bias. So to assess whether your data is random or not, we can use the test which is known as a Runge test. And there is a Brahm rules, aap keh sakte to chalo aise decision lene ke, the p value is less than or equal to 0.05 or alpha, reject at not. Otherwise, accept. So we never go for the what is the test statistics value. We never talk about what is the table value. We always look for the significant value. That is called the p value. And we compare the p-value with the level of significance. If we have considered that level of significance 5%, then compare with the 0.05. And if the p-value less than 0.05, reject the null hypothesis, otherwise accept the null hypothesis. So here I have a data. Even if your data is of a time series, then it does not satisfy this assumption or this test. Because here in this test, we say that data is of independent of order. And if hypothesis is rejected, it means that data is serially correlated. Okay. So test of independence of order, many statistical tests assume that the observation in a sample are independent. In other words, that the order in which the data were collected is irrelevant. That means they are random, or we can say that the way the data are collected, it is irrelevant. If the order does matters, then the sample is not random. If you are saying that the second observation is taken after, or there is a connection between the second observation and the first observation, second observation is always larger than the first observation, then the data become the order statistics. This should not be the scenario. Okay. So this means that data are serially correlated. The current observation depends on the previous observation. So if you wish to see that whether this data are random or not, so we can use the test which is known as a Runge test to see whether the data or whether the order of the values of variable is random or not. And for that, I can use the data file which is known as a serum cholesterol level. So quickly open the file. I have shared you the materials in which there is a folder of non-parametric, in which there is a folder fitting of distribution. Okay. Is it okay? Go to the file menu, go to the folders where the you have the data, in which there is a folder non-parametric test. In non-parametric test, you can have this file, fitting of distribution. Just you have to open this file. File menu, open, okay? So I'll just remove this. I don't want to give the path. Everyone has opened the file? Yes or no? If everyone has opened the file, then just make the changes, remove this part. I don't want to store the data file at somewhere. I wish to see that I can browse the file. So to browse the file, command name is a file.choose. And because my data is available in a notepad, is a text format, so the command required is known as a read.table. If I wish to take the data from notepad to R, then command name is a read.table. File.choose to browse the file, and because my first column, the first row contains the variable name, so header is equal to true. I will show you the data file. There is a serum cholesterol changes. So you can see that the first column having the variable name, okay, this, and that is how I have given header equal to true. And it has how many columns? It has a two column, one is serial number and second one is a SCC. So that is how, because it is notepad data, so command name is read.table. Suppose you store in a CSV format, then command is a read.csv. If your data is in SPSS, then command name is a read.spss. Okay, file.choose, that means you can browse the file. Just give the control enter. Okay. It will ask you to select the file. So I have stored at my place. So you have to just go to the non-parametric. In non-parametric, there is a file. You can see that serum cholesterol changes. Just open this file. So there is no error. It means that my entire, whatever the data I have given in a notepad file, now it is stored into the variable name data. Just enter this. Okay, so you can see that this is a showing the data. Okay, so what I have done, I have import the data from notepad to R via command read.table. Is that okay? No response.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now my data is available in the second column. So I have a, I can also say that the command names. I can say that how many variables are there. You can say that there are two variables. One name is a names. Okay. So two variables. The first is a serial number and second column is a SCC. So I have taken the data is a data file, square root comma two. It is nothing but I'm extracting the data and store into the variable name scc. So you can see that I am just control enter and I am explaining the command simultaneously. If I wish to find out the summary of this, the command name is a summary. So you can say that the minimum cholesterol changes is minus 97 and maximum is a 55. Mean is minus 10.89 and median is this. Okay, so you can say there is outlier present in your data. Now to see that whether your data is a random or not, so test name is a run dot test, test of randomness. Now it has given the error. When you run it, why error? Any idea? Why error? Just quickly.
Maybe we need some package or we have to load some library.
Yes, yes. So it is saying that run.test command is not there, or there is a error in the command name. There are two types. There are two possibilities. Either the corresponding library is not available, or corresponding command is incorrect. Command name is correct, but you require the library. So I have written here. You require to load the low state MBT norm and this. But RStudio has the advantage. If you just load the low state, it is automatically lacking the dependency. So how to load the packages? Mere saathi kijiye, click on packages. Here there is option packages. Okay. Then install. Package name is a LAWSPAT. So you can see that when you type, it is giving the option. Just select. Okay, and install. So it is taking the installation process. Okay. And then when you just, there is a search button after installation, you can just type the LAW. So it is showing the package. Yes, just click over here. That means the library low state is loaded. And now if you perform the run test, it has given the output. It has given the output. So test name is a runs test, and you have calculated the standardized run statistics, but we are not interested in this. We are interested in the p-value. And what is the p-value? What is the p-value? What is p-value?
0.145.
Which is less than 0.05 or greater than?
Greater than.
Greater than. So according to our rules, we should accept the hypothesis or reject?
Reject the hypothesis.
Let me go back. If it is less than, then reject. Otherwise, accept. Oh, so here, accept. Greater than, to accept. And what was the null hypothesis? Null hypothesis is a data is independent of order. Test of randomness. So that means it is a saying that data is independent of order. So there, data is a random. Okay, and that is what I have written here. The p-value is greater than 0.05, suggests that the serum cholesterol changes is randomly distributed. Okay?
Sir.
So whatever I have said, almost I have tried to write into the handout. So if something is missing, you can also go through that.
Sir, I have a query.
Yeah, please.
Sir, what is the test statistic for the for this run state test?
Test statistics? Here, sir, they have used the stand, normal. They have converted into the normal Z test.
Okay, that means standard normal is used here.
in a runs test, usually it is a binomial distribution is required, because how many observations are below the median and how many are the above. Okay.
Okay, so sir, is this a don't understand, because if this is based on binomial, so how the that means what is the background of this testing procedure? Can you tell something about that?
Actually, what happened when you are talking about the run test, basically you are saying that what is your objective? Your objective is that whether your data is a random or not. So here, as a users, what is our objective? We cannot go for detailing the mathematics. We can, as a users, we try to see that under which condition which should be applicable. Okay. So so here the thing is that which test is possible. So run test, if I wish to perform in R language, which command is useful? Okay, so run dot test. Where it is available? It is available in this library. And how to interpret? To look at the p value. If the p value less than 0.05, reject at not. What was the at not? The data is independent of order. So here the p value is greater than 0.05. We accept the null hypothesis that the data is independent of order. It is a class of statistics, then I can say that let x1, x2, xn is a random sample drawn from a binomial distribution. And then we say that how many plus and how many minus. And then positive runs and negative runs. And then it has the mean NPN variance is NPQ. Then convert into the standardized. If there is a correction, then remove the 0.5, minus 0.5, something like that. And then you compare approximately normal. But that is not the idea of this workshop. Okay. Okay. Any questions? Anyone? Okay. If no question, so sir, today we'll stop here.
Yes, sir.
And tomorrow we will. I will again revise you the basics of testing of hypothesis. Then this test of randomness. Again, we will perform this quickly, and then the.